Hello. Good afternoon. Welcome to this session on WCFS the new.NET. My name is Juval Lowy. How many of you, I'm curious, how many of you have heard me making such statement in the past? So I bet you're all curious to know what's going on. Okay. Now, normally the sessions I give at conferences like TechEd are all about the kung fu I'm doing with .NET and C Sharp, and this is not one of those sessions. This is a lighthearted session. We're not going to talk about, you know, the meaning of the code and such. We're going to talk about trends and productivity and your livelihood, actually. So what is going on? If you look at the official messaging for Microsoft and what is WCF, what is the one sentence definition for Microsoft on what is WCF? Web services, of course. Let's go back in time a little bit. It's going to be one of the first journeys back in time we're going to do. If you were to go back in time 9 years ago, 7 years ago, when .NET was first announced, what was the one sentence definition of .NET for Microsoft? Perhaps you should be a little bit concerned. Perhaps you have been here once before, a weird deja vu. My question to you, saying that .NET is about web services, is that a true or false statement? Well, I wouldn't say false. You can write web services in .NET, granted. But is this all there is to .NET? No. Much the same way, saying that WCF is about web services is the same degree of truth to it. Microsoft has never, ever said the following statement. We've got this new thing. You're all at the foothill of this humongous learning curve again. You should all have a lobotomy to free space in your brains. Good luck. Has anybody ever heard Microsoft saying that? No. No. In fact, they always try and obfuscate the truth in that respect. There's always this deception in marketing. The ultimate deception was, of course, VB.NET. I used to say that calling VB.NET, VB.NET is a feat of marketing deception that hasn't been achieved since the Vikings called Greenland, Greenland. Now, the reality is that WCF is actually the new.NET. It's actually more like the new C Sharp because of the way it kind of like makes you relearn what it means to program. But I'm not here to teach you about WCF. I'm here to make the provocative statement that every class should be a service. Now, to those of you uninitiated into WCF, you don't have to be to understand this session. WCF is an interception-based framework. The client interacts with the proxy. Graphically, it looks like this. The client talks to a proxy. The proxy takes the incoming stack frame of the client, the parameters, and so on, prepares a WCF message out of it, runs it to a set of interceptors on the client side, let's call them channels, to do some pre-call processing. Things like grabbing the client transaction, putting it in the message, grabbing the client credential, putting it in the message, initiating a session ID, and so on, and then into a transport channel of some sort. The message goes into the wire. It can be a network wire, it can be a pipe, it can be a queue. Up the other side, where another transport channel is monitoring the communication, takes the message, does some pre-call processing on the service side, things like decrypting the message, decoding it, authenticating the client, authorizing it, grabbing the transaction, acquiring a lock, doing some logging, whatever it is. And then a dispatcher takes a WCF message and converts it to a C# class and calling your object. By the time the call actually reaches here, it's just a C# call. It is actually just a normal C# land call. And that's how WCF is capable of actually doing its various services. Now, what are those things that those things actually do? Well, I've got a list here. One of the things WCF can do for you is encrypt all the calls. You do nothing, all calls are encrypted. It can also authenticate. In fact, by default, it authenticates and encrypts all the calls. It propagates identities down the call chain. In normal .NET, if A calls B and B asks .NET, who calls me, what will .NET say? I have no idea. So you frantically Google it and you find out you have to say appdomain.setcount principal security permission, but fine, you call it. And then A calls B and B asks .NET, who calls me, and what will .NET say? B. Who came up with that? Not in WCF. If A calls B in WCF, B asks WCF who calls me, you get A. There's identity propagation. Calls are automatically authorized against Windows roles, ASP.NET providers, whatever you like. There's a beautiful security audit trail of everything that happened. WCF automatically propagates transaction. You do nothing. It's completely hands-off. You don't have to begin transaction, end it, give it to somebody, enlist, begin, commit, nothing. The whole thing just happens. It votes for you, propagates it. All calls are timed out. What does it mean? In normal.NET, if you call an object, do you know in advance it's not going to deadlock on you? Do you know it's not going to go into an infinite loop? Do you know if it's not going to take 4 days to process the call? No. As a result, if you care about what you do, you never just call an object. You take a worker thread, let the worker thread take the risk of calling the object, and then you monitor some kind of an event that the thread is supposed to signal by the time the call returns, and then if you can actually monitor for how long you were blocking on the event, and then if it's more than 5 milliseconds, whatever your tolerance is, you say, well, I don't want to wait anymore. Oh, and by the way, you have to do it for every call on every object from now to the end of time. Anybody's doing that? No, you pretend the problem doesn't exist. Why? Because it's an insane programming model. You rather bury your head in the sand. Yeah, it's not going to deadlock. But every once in a while, your application does this. And the user will do this. Hence my statement, this is the .NET salute. But in WCF, because of the interception, you can have the proxy do all these shenanigans with timeouts and thread, and just if the call times out, it just throws an exception on your side. Calls can be made reliably. If somebody unplugs the router, if some cable monkey moves the router, whatever, your call is gone. But in WCF, because of reliability, you can actually pick it up. You can have very elaborate tracing and logging infrastructure with a beautiful graphical viewer that shows you how calls propagated between your objects and tracing and logging. More than 120 performance counters that instrument everything you ever want to instrument on your object. Number of calls per second, number of calls failed, number of transactions. Whatever you want to instrument, it's there. Sophisticated instance management techniques that lets you choose if you want to optimize for throughput or for scalability and how you manage durability of your objects so that if a long period of time passes between calls, you have to actually worry about it. It doesn't matter if it's 2 seconds between the call or 4 years. You're going to get the object and use it. Very nice error masking. In .NET, there's all these collection of exceptions. You can actually catch this and catch that. It turns out that programming against a particular exception is a really bad idea. Because now you're coupled into the nature of the error. As the nature of the error evolves over time because something else happens, your error handling logic on the client has to change. This is why C# never supported declared exceptions, which is a bad idea in Java. Take it to the next step. Why betray any kind of error information against the client? Look, something bad happened, that's all you need to know. Now, in normal C#, it means you have to put a big try and catch in every object and never just let any exception up the call stack. You catch it and you saw instead an opaque system exception. But that's not easy to do, but in WCF, that's exactly what happened. The interception chain will not betray the nature of the error. In normal C#, if you call an object and it had an exception, you can catch it, turn around and call it again. Right? Who came up with that? Think about it. The object blew up. There's body parts and blood all over the place. You pretend it didn't happen, you're going to call it again? Now, if you are concerned about that, here's what you need to do. Inside every object, you have a bit called I'm already dead. And you have a big try and catch in every method. And the first thing you do inside every method, you check if the bit is already set, I'm already dead. And of course, in every exception, you catch it, you set the bit to true, and you throw it again. Anybody's doing that? On every method, on every object, from now to the end of time? Of course not. It's an insane programming model. But you know, in WCF, let the interceptor figure it out. The exception on the way back faults the channel. You can't call it after an exception again. All calls are buffered. All calls are throttled. What does it mean? The dumbest, or the simplest object written by the dumbest developer can bring any system to its knees. It's just a question of cranking up the load. Software systems are not elastic. You can't just, you're chewing them, keep stretching and stretching and stretching. At some point, it just snaps and breaks. And you've all seen it firsthand. How many times you're working with Windows, minding your own business, Explorer is up, Outlook is up, You open another folder and Windows goes into catatonic shock. And for 2 minutes you cannot do anything. You can't even move the mouse. You snap Windows. What happened? One more handle.
One handle too far. That's what happened.
But in WCF, it can actually monitor these things, and you give it certain gateway, no more than so many concurrent calls, no more than so many instances, per object, of course, it will actually prevent it from taking down your system. Enormous tolerance is the kind of data you're willing to work with and tolerances. In normal.NET, there isn't really good tolerances. You have to get exactly what you were compiled against. That's the guarantee of .NET, right? Now, it sounds like a good idea. Except it's not if you want to innovate. Because if you want to introduce new things, well, you know what's going to happen? Nothing. We'll get exactly what it was compiled against. Now, .NET offers you ways of overriding the .NET version resolution policy, but then it risks some kind of some other issues. So, in fact, when it comes to versioning of your data, if you want to rename fields, add fields, remove fields, .NET prevents you with a fork in the road. And there's two options to choose. One, complete stifling of innovation. Two, DLL hell. Now, it's not all bad news. You can choose which one you like. But in WCF, you never actually pass anything by reference. Interception mechanism can actually check what is going on and kind of like be tolerant against that. So if you rename a field or add a field, it will actually let it go. And there's ways of actually massaging it further. All calls are synchronized. In normal C#, you're completely and utterly exposed. Most developers cannot handle multi-threading. Anybody dispute that statement? I've yet to see a single multi-threaded application that doesn't have issues, if you know what I mean. Now, it used to be that to really understand threading, you have to spend decades of your time understanding the synchronization issues. Most people did not. Now, as long as most people were using VB, that wasn't a big idea. It wasn't a big deal. But that has drastically changed with .NET. In the early days of .NET, when I learned that .NET is going to give VB developers access to a multi-threaded environment, I said that this is like giving razor blades to babies. It doesn't mean that razor blades are bad. You just don't give them to babies. Here's a little baby, here's a razor blade, they chop off all the fingers. It doesn't mean the razor blade is bad. You just don't give razor blades to babies. Now, it's not that the C++ guys were any better off. They were just more accustomed to blood. But in WCF, the interception mechanism can detect if there's somebody already home and refuse to let the concurrent call in. You do nothing. All calls are synchronized. In fact, take it to the next level. You don't even have to test concurrency issues. How about that for a statement? In .NET, if you're trying to update, say, a form on the wrong thread, what happens? Kaboom, right? So I've published my fair share about background worker and threads and all sorts of things, and I implemented the background worker in 1.0, anticipating 2.0, and all these things, right? Yes, you can solve it like this, but that's really a clever way of solving. There's a better solution. WCF intercepts the calls anyway. Can you pay attention and see that I'm about to jump into that thread over there that's not what I was looking for, just bounce the call for me? That's exactly what can happen in WCF. By default, the class will jump to the correct thread it needs to execute on. You don't need to do anything about it. Nothing. All calls are potentially remotable. What does it mean? If you're all in the same process, same domain, that's fine. What if you want to move to another process, another machine? Zero changes to your application. Zero. None. Unlike even .NET remoting or DCOM that implies horrible changes to your system. Calls can be made in an interoperable manner. Now it's just .NET. What if you want to do some Java and Linux in the future as a client? Well, if you're just .NET, then you've got some serious issues here. You have to program to the lowest common denominator, which usually dumb down your application to the point that various other things creep in. But in WCF, it's all based on standard. You don't have to do anything about it. All calls can be made in a queued manner. Now, .NET has system.messaging API. You can program against message queues. You can post and pick and poke and read and get and lock and get the thing. You get the parameters and take the parameters, put the message, put the percent over there, and now the thread is listening on the queue. Oh, get the message, get the message, get the message out, lock the queue, get the parameter, take it over, put it in. Tell me I'm missing something. Right, it's just shoving goo all over the place. The customer doesn't care if I'm dealing with system.messaging. They just want to make the call. But in WCF, you can say, you know, that wire I showed you, it's actually a queue. And the proxy and the interception on both sides will do this conversion from C-sharp land to MSMQ land back and forth. You don't have to do anything about it. If you do want to export things as a web service, WCF provides the service bus relay that lets you marshal away any differences between network under translation and IPs and static IPs and DNSs, all of that just goes away. In 4.0, there's also discovery. You don't have to actually even know where the service is. You just say, okay, who supports that service, and you're going to get it. So look how many features we have here. It takes two slides with three columns of bullets. Each and every one of them is worthy of a chapter in a book, an article in MSDN magazine. And how much it costs you as far as what you need to program? Nothing. It's already there. And so let me propose to you the first statement. Surely you must agree that ideally, all classes should be services. Sure, then I'm going to get all the bullets here and all the bullets here. Is there anybody here that doesn't want these bullets? No, every application needs these bullets. We agree? Yes. So ideally, all classes should be services. But I know what's burning in the back of your minds. I know why all you're dying to ask me. I know the question. Sadly, the question that all of you are dying to ask me is the wrong question. And none of you actually want to ask me the right question. So here's what we'll do. We'll answer the wrong question thoroughly. We'll discuss why you have asked me the wrong question. Then we'll ask the right question, and we'll answer that one as well. Okay? In fact, I have here a copy of my book, and I will give that to the first person in the crowd to ask me the right question. I do not want to go home with this book. And so the question you're all dying to ask me is, what about performance? You're all just dying to ask me. I mean, there's all these 30 bullets of things going on. But yes, I mean, surely it's not free. Of course. Turns out you've all been had. Why? Because nobody cares. What does it mean? Developers have a fixation about the performance, but people of substance who actually care, like customers and managers, they don't really care. And I can prove it to you. Anybody here is a manager? A manager in the room? You're among friends? What's your name, lady? Christine. Yes. Suppose you're my manager and I'm your technical lead. And I come to you with the following statement. Christine, we've already met whatever we're supposed to do as far as performance. Performance is already adequate. However, with the remaining of the time we have on this project, we can do two things. We can improve performance by 200%. We've got some ways we think we can make it better by 200%. Or we can improve the schedule by 20%. Which one would you choose? Which was schedule? Christine doesn't care. Nobody cares. So why are developers obsessed with the wrong question? It turns out that more important questions such as what is the commitment of management to quality? What kind of a mature process are you using? Did you spend enough time with the marketing guy collecting the requirements? These questions far outweigh, can we tweak it a few more nanoseconds over here? But these things are outside the control of developers. In addition, other things which are important, like design, are intangible. You cannot measure them. You can't go to somebody and say, my design is 37% better than yours. I'd love to make that statement. I can't. So developers focus on two things. They think they can measure, and they think they control. Doesn't make it important. It just means this is why you focus on it. Okay? This is searching under the streetlight. You know the joke? The guy's walking down the street, see a friend of his on all four doing this on the pavement. He's saying, what are you doing? He says, well, I dropped my car keys. He says, well, near my car. Where is your car? It's around the curve. So what are you doing here? The streetlight is here. I'm searching here. That's performance. So now we know why you were all obsessed with it. We have to, of course, answer that. Now, it turns out that if you were to look at the history of software engineering, going back decades ago, to the 60s, to the 70s, there is a trend, which is the first trend we're going to discuss this afternoon, that if there's one thing you can always, always, always count on it, and there are no exceptions, as you move between technology generations, there is one thing you always do. And that thing is you always, 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 always trade performance for productivity. Let's walk down memory lane here. In the 60s, suppose you were developers and you were programming against PDP-5 or whatever, you're writing assembly and so on. And then in 1973, C comes along. Now, when C first was proposed, it was first Algol 6, first it was B, and then it was Algol 68, and then it was B, and then it was C in 73, all the assembly developers were scoffing at C. All the assembly developers in the early 70s said the following thing. C? Have you seen the assembly generated by the C compiler? It's brain-dead assembly. There's jumps that go two lines below, one line below. You can write much better assembly by hand. And they were absolutely correct. Even today, if you look at the assembly generated by the C compiler, it's brain-dead assembly. You can write much better assembly by hand. But you know what? By 1973, I wasn't running on some PDP-5. I was running on a PDP-11. 8-bit machine. That machine was so fast, you can write the entire operating system in C. It's called Unix. That is how fast that machine was. And yes, I can do a better job in assembly, but I'll take the benefit of structured programming, of for statements, of while statements and such, over raw assembly any day of the week. And apparently we've got some issues here. No, this is just Vista issues. Sometimes it decides not to play along with the projector. And it has happened before, by the way. Not just to me, to others. Let's try and switch back. Looks good, yes. So, if you were to look at 1973, I'll take the benefits of C programming over assembly any day of the week. I'd like for loops. I like while loops. I like those things. Good. And then a few years go by, and in the early, middle 80s, C++ comes along. And all the C developers are scoffing at C++. They're all saying, C++? That's just a preprocessor for C. And every time you make a call, you're actually passing a this. So that is a factor of 2 on every call. And if there's a function, you have to actually go through a virtual table to go and pick it up as a function of another 2. That's a factor of 4 on every call now. Yes, that's true. C++ is slower than C. But you know what? By then, I wasn't running on a PDP-11 anymore. I was running on an amazing 6 megahertz ATPC. Those machines were so fast, they had the button to slow them down. And yes, it's slower, but I'll take the benefit of object orientation, encapsulation, and polymorphism between classes, and operator overloading, and all that thing. I do a plus, who knows what a mountain of code is injected there, and templates later on over C. Yeah, so it's slower. I'll take it. And then, as the 90s progressed, we realized objects is kind of like, they suck. We really need components, actually. And things like binary components, eventually Olay, and then COM comes along. In 1994, COM comes along. And all the C++ developers are scoffing at COM. They're all saying, COM? Have you ever measured COM compared to C++? I have, actually. It's 1,000 to 1 slower, actually. Every call is actually a call to a proxy, and a proxy converts that into a Windows message, and the Windows message goes into an apartment, the apartment pumps messages, and then it actually converts it back to a call, and then over there, and if that's if you're lucky, it's in the same apartment, and if you do LPC and RPC and type library marshalling, you load the type library, you create a proxy, you shove it in there, you get it there, into the message loop, into the other side, right? Right. 1,001:1 is reasonably conservative to how much COM was slower compared to C++. But, you know, by then I wasn't running on AT anymore. I was running an amazing 486DX. Remember the DX? That most of the time was doing this anyway. I looked at it. It was doing nothing. And yes, it's slow as a dog compared to C++. But I'll take the benefit of binary compatibility. So I can take a component and drop it on a VB4. And I'll take the ability to embed Excel inside Word. I'm going to take all these things. Yes. Yes, it's slower, but I'm getting so much. True. But then, by the way, I was saying, I was already active, and I was saying, you know, every class should be a COM object. And everybody said I'm nuts. You're nuts, they said. A few years gone by, and .NET comes along. And all the COM developers are scoffing at .NET. They're saying .NET is slow as a dog compared to COM. All this JIT compiling of the IL at runtime and so on. In fact, in .NET, something is interesting. In .NET, every class is a COM object. Every class you write is a COM object. In fact, it's worse than a COM object because you've got all the JIT compiler and the stack work for security and all that stuff happening as well. You wish it's just a COM object. It's not. But in .NET, actually, everything is a COM object. Okay? Yes, it's slow as a dog compared to COM. Probably, I don't know, another 100 or 1,000:1. Anybody here is not using .NET? Okay. The fact that you chose .NET over COM says something. You agree with the statement that it's always good to trade performance for productivity. That's what that statement means. Now, I want to show you something, but for that, I need to project. I'm going to try and grab another cable here. Let's see if it's going to do us any good. Got some luck here. Okay, I'm not going to try and change the resolution here. Maybe I'm going to try and feel lucky. Okay. I've got a question to ask you. What is this? Well, it's a C# class, you say. Really? Is that a class? Is that a class in the C++ sense of the word class? No, this is a full-fledged binary component. You agree? It's got GUIDs, it's got VTables, it's got everything. Right? Right. Look, I'll prove it to you. Before, I'm going to show the type, and let's get the GUID. Here, where does this come from? It's all COM under the covers, except I don't have to actually deal with the COM goo. But I'm still paying for COM in every class. Right? Right. By the way, there is a reason this is so. It's not just your classes. Look, do you think that the integer is not a COM object? Yes, it is actually. In fact, here is the integer. It's a monster structure that supports 17 different interfaces. And by the way, it is a COM object. Is it truly a word in memory, as in COM? No. It's this monster. Why are we paying for this monster? Why? I'll tell you why. Because you actually really like the following. Okay, would anybody blink at the code I just wrote? Let's look at it. You say, sure, of course. There's nothing to it, right? Let's reminisce what it would take to write this code in C++. We have an integer that's truly a word in memory. You need to convert it now to a string. How do you do that? I mean, how many digits would fit in the buffer and how do you do that? Well, if you're lucky, there's colon, colon, str, blah, 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 something to something else. You go and you frantically search for one, there's an API. Now, of course, to actually exercise it, you have to allocate the buffer. So you do mem alloc and you get the buffer. Now, how big is the buffer is another issue. You don't exactly know because it could be too many digits. You assume it's going to be big enough, you get a few extra, and you get one. Then you take the integer, you take the str something, and you copy into the buffer. Then you take this, but of course, strings are actually immutable. So you have to take a third buffer. First of all, you take a second buffer and put this text in it. Do you see me doing mem alloc for number equal? You didn't see me doing it, but you have to do it in C++. So I'm creating a second buffer, and I'm putting N-U-B-E-R, I'm putting this thing in it. Then I'm creating a third buffer, and now I have to concatenate these two, three strings into a third string. Now, if you like it, there's also strcat that will let you do it for you, but of course now there's usually with some other things. But suppose you're lucky, you take the third buffer, you put everything in it. Then you go and you dig into your APIs and you find colon colon message box A, not to be confused with colon colon message box W, and you put the third buffer in that call, plus some 17 other parameters for the call with the buttons and the icons and so on. You execute that, the user click the button, you undo this whole thing, you de-alloc, if you're lucky, you remember to do that, all the three buffers you've just created. 15 lines later, with a lot of pointers kung fu, you are done. Wasn't this somewhat easier? I guarantee you it wasn't more performant. Right? Right. And this is why you want the integer to be a monster. Because you want this programming model. Now, if we go back, if we go back to this slide, in .NET, every class is a COM object. I just showed that to you. Now, I'm not saying that every class in every application can be categorically a WCF service. I'm not saying that. There's a whole set of applications you cannot do this way. You can't write a device driver this way. You cannot do Google this way. But for a regular business application that's already using .NET, if you are already using .NET, you're so way down that trend anyway, take the next step. Right? All I'm saying is that if you can use .NET for your application for every class, with its enormous overhead for every class, you can use WCF. That's my statement. Now, WCF is not free. Of course it's not free. But it doesn't really matter. Why? Because the real application never notices it. It's more likely that the real bottleneck of your application will be things like going to SQL or going on a network. Not the WCF invocation. So it doesn't really matter if there's a cost for WCF. The question is it a bottleneck or not? Right? In fact, it doesn't actually matter if it is a bottleneck. The real question is it the bottleneck? I could have a number of bottlenecks. I'm accessing the network and SQL and WCF. Now, only the narrowest bottleneck counts as to limiting my application. Right? If I go to this bottleneck, and then this one, and then this one, then only this one counts. In fact, it doesn't actually matter if it is the bottleneck. The only question you always ask yourself is, if it is the bottleneck, and after going through the bottleneck, is performance adequate or not? Because if it is the bottleneck, but performance is still adequate, great. It's great. I get all the productivity benefits, and I don't really have to worry about it. Because Christian doesn't care. Right? So now we understand how to ask the question, what about performance? Now, what about the answer? Well, I did some benchmarking. So I take a single client and a single class, and the class is not doing any work inside curly brace inside the method. And I ran against it WCF, and I call it raw WCF. I turned off every last aspect of WCF. Turned off security, transaction, everything. There's nothing there. WCF is all the interception and the conversion of the call to WCF messages and into the channel up the other side and so on, did 10,000 calls per second. My question to you is, 10,000 calls per second good enough for your application? And we know the answer is, maybe it's not good enough for Google, but for a business application, of course. But Rossi Sharp, in the same case, did 300,000 calls per second. 30 times faster. So now we know, by the way, in broad strokes, what would be the penalty for WCF, about 30 to 1. Now, raw WCF is more than adequate for the vast majority of applications. Anybody in this room, it's adequate for. But tell me something. Are you gaining anything from using WCF this way? And the answer is no. Raw WCF adds no value whatsoever to your application. Why are you using it? You turned off all the feature and you're using it so you could say you're using it? There's no value. Never use raw WCF. In fact, you should use it, or you should use it precisely because it adds some value, because you want the security, or you want the reliability, or you want the queuing, or you want the remote call, or any one of those 30 bullets I showed you. Right? In which case, you know, if you want some feature, it's okay to pay for it. Because what is the alternative? The alternative is you not using WCF and plugging in that feature yourself. My question to you is, let's compare it blow for blow. Suppose it's security. Do you think you can outperform Microsoft security? What about transactions? Think you can outperform their transaction management? Blow for blow, they will outperform whatever you do. I can ask him politely to turn off the phone. Thank you. Although your sentiments resonate with me. Now, blow for blow, Microsoft would do a better job outperforming anything you do. And it's not an accident. It's not your job to be the world's best security expert or the world's best transaction manager expert. Your customer doesn't pay you. They pay you for some business value. On the other hand, Microsoft, that's their bread and butter. That's what they do. And not only that's what they do, they have dedicated performance engineers. Now, you think that the guys who are doing the code for WCF and so on, they're already thinking about performance. That's true. But after they're done, performance engineers get to work. What are performance engineers? Performance engineers are guys that are so smart, they had to extend the doorways in Building 42 to allow those guys' heads to just fit through the doorway. And Building 42 has already got the smartest guys on Redmond to begin with, okay? And, you know, I mean, after some unfortunate incidents, they had to change some regulation at Redmond. They actually forbid now more than 3 performance engineers in a room at the same time. Do you know why? Because the brain mass involved is so great, they can actually create an intellectual black hole and collapse the universe around them. Are those guys working on your performance issues? Because those are the guys that worked on the WCF performance issues. There is no way you can do a better job. So if you're using it, it's okay to pay. More than that, not only is it okay to pay, it's the only way to gain performance. Think of it. Because per aspect, WCF will outperform whatever you do, if the alternative is you do it yourself or use WCF, if you care about performance, you have to use WCF. And not 1 in 1,000 developers would make that observation out of the gate. Interesting. Now, so far I used WCF in a raw format. But let's use it with every last aspect turned on. And let's do it demanding. Let's do it over text encoding, using HTTP for transport. Let's do it with 120 performance counters. Let's do it with reliability. Let's do it with message security. Okay? In fact, if you do that, and I happen to have a little stress test here, I can show you the config. It doesn't really matter. It's everything I just told you is actually configured there. And we run it, and we can even look at performance counters here. We just make a few calls. So you can see that I'm doing well over 200 calls per second here with everything turned on. No longer is it 10,000 calls per second. Okay? With all the bells and whistles tied in, you're doing about 200 on a little laptop with everything running on it. On a server machine, you would get better numbers. There's no denying it. On a server machine, you're going to get 300 to 500 calls per second. It's a drastic reduction from 10,000, no denying it. But is it good enough or not? Because Christine doesn't care. Let me suggest to you that you can't do Google this way at 300 calls per second. And you can't do a device driver. But for a regular business application, and this is with everything turned on, let me suggest to you it is adequate. Now, so far, this little demo I just did, there was no work at all inside the service. Curly brace, curly brace, but all the plumbing wired it up was there. Okay? You could say, yes, that's not really my application. My application does real work. What is real work? I'm accessing a database. I'm calling other services. I'm crunching numbers on a CPU. I'm processing images. I'm executing a rule engine. I'm executing a workflow. I'm touching the drive. I'm going in the network. I'm updating the GUI. Yes, 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 yes. And yes, this is what you do in your application, right? Now, this is added value to some customer. Don't you agree that when you do real-life work, you require real design and real aspects? Sure. You want transaction, you want security, you want reliability, you want these things because you're doing real work, right? So let's talk about a single client talking to a real system. Now, anytime you're trying to do a benchmark of a system, there has to be some kind of a reference system, stock trading or whatever it is, because unless it's a curly brace to curly brace, close, close, all systems are different. So I could pick any kind of a system, but I was fortunate enough, about 2 years ago, I did some work with a customer. We designed a system, and the system was kind of like a garden variety business application. It wasn't too big, it wasn't too small. It was receiving calls from individual clients, calls from a batch. It was making calls from a web service and calls from intranet clients. It had all the goodies. And I said to the customer, you know, this is, and it had also lots of layers and business logic and managers and engines. Those of you in my session yesterday know exactly what I'm talking about. And we had this whole nice architecture. I said to the customer, look, it's not part of this engagement, but I would like to actually benchmark it with and without WCF at the most granular atomic level, at every class, basically. They said, this is just for me. And they said, no, we want to know, too. I said, fine, I'm going to bill you for that, too. So I ran the testing. And on a real system that does the kind of real work I just described, WCF did about 100 calls per second. No longer was it doing 500 calls per second. Why is that? It's because the system had layers. And while it is true when you are measuring and profiling things, only the narrowest bottleneck matters, the length of the pipe matters as well. Okay? A pipe, you know, a foot wide and a mile long has more drag than a foot, than 6 inches wide and 2 foot long, right? Now, nobody has, you know, an application that searches for a mile, but if you have, say, 5 layers and you're still using WCF between the layers, it's roughly divided by the number of layers, and that application had 4 or 5 layers, you drop from 300 to 500 to about 100, give or take. So it matches. In the same scenario, C# did some 400 to 500 calls per second. No longer are we talking about 300,000 calls per second. Now, at that point, we're using C#, using it in a classic client-server model. There are no aspects because raw.NET gives you zero security, zero transaction, zero reliability, zero remote calls, zero anything. It's not there. Right? Right. Now, when I showed you this slide, it had an intention. The intention here was you all had to agree that real life requires real design. You all agreed to that. Now, if we look at this case, this is actually an unreal scenario because I had real work and yet I didn't have real design. So I entrapped you in this slide to agree with me in this slide that C# is actually an unreal scenario. It's not fair to compare a real scenario with an unreal scenario. Right? Right. And then I did another thing on that system. I said, it's a different thing if it's one client versus multiple clients. So on the same real system, I had multiple clients making concurrent client calls. WCF did 100 calls per second. Why? Because WCF is inherently scale invariant. Because of the instance management technique plus the throttling, you don't really care if it's one client, 10,000 clients, it's all the same. So you basically stay at 100 calls per second. If you choose things like per call and you do throttling, you're not going to notice anything as the scalability increases, as the load increases, basically, because I was doing multiple clients with concurrent calls. Interesting thing is what happened when raw C-sharp was tested in the same scenario. C-sharp dropped like a stone to about 1, maybe 10 calls per second. No longer is it 500 calls per second, 1 call per second. Why? I've managed to verify and demonstrate yet again that the classic client server doesn't scale. Why is that? It turns out that if you have multiple concurrent clients, all using classic client server, all clients running with own security identities, there isn't really any way of managing the underlying resources. So if you have 5,000 clients, you will need 5,000 connections to your database. What would the database behave at 5,000 connection level? Poorly. You have any doubt? But with WCF, because you can actually have very easily process boundaries, you can have all your middle tier running under a separate identity, in a single identity, you can have a connection pool with one connection in it serving 5,000 clients. Your system is not even breaking a sweat. Similar arguments happen about also about transaction management, transaction locking, and so on. This is why C-sharp or classic client server doesn't scale. Okay? And so this table summarizes for you the benchmarks I told you about. Raw C-sharp, 300,000 calls per second. Impressive. Or WCF, 10,000 calls per second. Both are totally unreal scenario because I'm not really doing any real application either here or here. If you're talking about a real application with raw C-sharp, you're doing about 400 to 500. WCF, you're doing about the same number. But if you start adding concurrent calls, C-sharp dropped like a stone. WCF stays at the 100 level. Now, is 100 calls per second, worst case, good enough for most applications? Look back at yourself and say yes. I wouldn't do a device driver this way. I wouldn't do a Google this way. But for your average business application, the answer is yes. And this is with everything turned on a real application. And remember the alternative, the unthinkable alternative. You're doing it yourself. Now, one disclosure here. When I'm saying full WCF, the only feature I didn't benchmark was full logging and tracing. It turns out that if you turn on full logging and tracing, WCF at verbose level dumps 1.2 meg per call. At which point, I'll be benchmarking my drive under stress test, not WCF. So that one I had to take out. But other than that, okay. So now, what do we see? We clearly see the first bullet. In real application, there's no real impact for treating every class as a service. While utilizing every last aspect of WCF, over the slowest encoding, the slowest transport, the slowest security, right? I was doing it with the slowest possible. Again, in real application, there's no real impact for treating every class as a service while utilizing every last aspect of WCF. Totally counterintuitive, of course. Hence, bullet two, every class should be a service. And now you understand what I've been babbling about all this time. Now, that's just the beginning. This is just some numbers I can throw your way. It gets more interesting once we look again at the history of how we got to this very place. And we've already discussed the overarching trend that every time you jump technology generation, you always trade performance for productivity. There are no exceptions. Certainly, moving from .NET to WCF at such a granular level would abide by that law. A factor of 30 to 1, easily. Right? But there's another trend that also spans decades that leads me to believe every class should be a service. And that particular trend is not evident merely by examining a generation N to N plus 1 shift. That trend is visible only if you take a longer perspective that spans maybe two or three generations. Then you see another trend on top of the trading performance and productivity. That trend is all new ideas in software always manifest themselves in three waves. First comes the methodology, then comes the technology, then comes the platform. What do I mean by that? Again, let's walk down memory lane. And let's look at, say, assembly developers versus C developers. And suppose it's the late 60s. There is no C compiler. It doesn't exist. Do you really have to wait to 1973 to do structured programming in assembly? Absolutely no. If you know what you're doing, if you're a disciplined, careful assembly developer, you have structures that look very much like functions, and you have do loop and while loops. You have the whole thing. Now, of course, not every assembly developer did that. Only the smartest one did that. Everybody else had this big, you know, spaghetti, horrible thing. But the other guys structured their code. But that requires an enormous degree of discipline, competence, conviction. This is the right way of doing things. Most people didn't have it. SIP comes along in 1973. It's a technology. All of a sudden, every developer can do structured programming. Every developer has for loops and while loops and functions. You don't have to be a genius assembly developer, right? Right. And tell me, do you have to wait until 1983 or 1985 for C++ to do object orientation? Absolutely not. In the 70s, people already realized the shortcoming of procedural programming with C, and that the right way of doing things is structuring it with objects. So how would you do it? Well, you have to know what you're doing. You never just go and take a function and bounce over a bunch of global variables in C. No, no, no. Every function gets a handle to a structure. And the structure contains the state of the object, the logical object you're trying to manage. And you never go and do anything besides that object. And you can even have inheritance. You can have virtual function. You have a table of function pointers. And you never just go and invoke a function in C. You go into the function pointer table, pick up the address, and invoke that. Of course, that involves the syntax from hell. Parenthesis, parenthesis, star, parenthesis, arrow, parenthesis, close, close, pointer, star, blast, close parenthesis, comma, parenthesis, right? But, you know, that is how it goes to the V table. In fact, you can even do overriding methods this way. Go to the V table, change the pointer, and now you override the method. But what kind of competence in C it requires to do that? A lot. The bar was so high, most C developers couldn't do it. Couldn't do it beyond the reach. But the smart ones did that. So we see that we had a wonderful methodology, but there was no technology for it. How did Bjorn Stryktorp come up with all those ideas for C++? He walked down the aisles at AT&T and asked the smart guys he appreciated, what do they do? And he codified it in a language. C++ comes along, mere mortals can do object orientation. You don't have to be a genius C developer. You declare a class, you call a method, you say virtual, it's all there. So what do we have? We have a beautiful technology for doing the methodology. But C++ on its own is sterile. It doesn't do anything. As a result, in the late 80s, every C++ developer's worth his salt was walking around in the seat of the pants with a floppy. It was a real floppy, the kind you can bend. I had one with half a meg, and I had the entire C++ developer's compiler on it, plus the help file in half a meg. And I also had my little library. What did I have there? I had things like, say, a smart array. Because in C++, if you go out of bound, you start corrupting memory. You don't know about it. 2 days later, you're going to crash somewhere else. Go and figure this one out. No, no, no. I override the square bracket operator, and I check the index is out of bound, and then I blow you up with the error happen, not when the symptoms are discovered, right? And that crazy kung fu with the strings, forget about that. I had a plus operator against C string class that concatenates these things. And on and on and on and on. And every team became a technical lead for, I laid down the law. This is how we do things here. Here's the floppy, here are the classes. Because C++ on its own is sterile. What if your team at the time didn't have a competent technical lead to provide you the infrastructure? You're not really utilizing C++. Because on its own, it's sterile. Plus, if somebody moves from one team, one product, to another team, or another company, you have to relearn all the indigenous way of doing things over there. What liberated C++ was MFC. MFC is much more than just a GUI framework for Windows. MFC is a full-fledged C++ platform. You have C window, but you also have C string, C array, C archive, C object, support for serialization, bridge pattern for streams. It's all there. Because of MFC in the early 90s, C++ exploded on the Microsoft platforms. You just couldn't do it without a platform. But it took a long time. It took 15 years from the methodology of OO in the 70s to the technology in the 80s to the platform in the 90s. But by then, in the early 90s, we begin to realize OO kind of suck. We really need components. But how do you do components? Well, you can start assigning unique IDs to class libraries, and you put it in a dictionary and use a dictionary to go and get the IDs and learn everything and so on. Yes, you can do these things. But how many DLL developers did this kind of a thing that you never just go and create an object, you go to a class factory that actually gets you the components from where it's supposed to be based on some unique IDs, you manage some kind of a dictionary. How many did that? Not so many. I did that because I knew that I had to have binary compatibility. I knew I needed components. But not many did that. It was a wonderful methodology, component orientation, but there wasn't technology. COM comes along in 1994. Bam! A technology. Now every developer can do COM. You do nothing. File new ATL, okay, you get COM objects. You don't have to implement IUnknown by hand. You don't have to implement registry scripts. Nothing. It's already there. You just write your COM objects. Right? Right. So it's a wonderful technology to implement the methodology. Unfortunately, that wasn't just what needed then, because COM was unnecessarily ugly. Why? The language you used for COM, C++, didn't know anything about COM. You couldn't just say new and do it. You had to say call create instance and delete. And then addref, addref, delete, 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 addref, addref, delete, delete. And the platform you're adding on top is Windows. Windows know nothing about COM. COM is bolted on top of Windows. So you can't just go and bounce between services. Call Marshall into stream and release. Remember that? And of course, in Service Pack 3 for NT4, you had the global interface table. You take a reference to the interface, you check into the Git, you get a cookie, you take the cookie, put it in another thread, the other thread, take the cookie, go to the Git, get a Marshall reference. This is incredibly ugly. Why? Because the language and the operating system knew nothing about your technology. What we needed was a platform. We needed support for COM at the atomic level, that every class becomes a COM object, at the language level, and that is .NET. .NET is nothing but cleaned up COM. Everything in COM is just there, but you don't have to actually sweat about it. Right? Right. Instead of a registry for the dictionary to look up the IDs, we've got the global interface table. Instead of GUIDs, we have strong names. Everything else is there. Instead of IDL, we have the CLI. It's the same thing. Now, with .NET, you don't have to actually sweat too much to work, take the components to work. Now, if the language knows nothing about components, deprecate the language, be it C++, and come up with a new language that has support at the atomic level for components, where the class is a component and the integer is a component. Yes. We call it C#. And if the OS knows nothing about components, toss the OS, come up with a new OS. Now, Microsoft could not call the CLR a new Windows, so they call it a common language runtime. But it is an operating system. Put on top of Windows. Right? Right. And so, finally, with .NET in 2002, we have the emergence of the component platform. But by then, we begin to realize that, the components are fine, really need services. Now, service orientation as a methodology is nice. But did you try and implement secure messaging over SOA in 2002, 2004? Who could do it? Well, Michelle could do it, and Clemens could do it, but that's about it. You have to be a genius to do service orientation in the early 2000s, right? I mean, it's a nice methodology. There's no way you can do it with .NET. The technology is just component orientation. It's not service orientation. It's not service oriented. The language knows nothing about services. It knows about components. It doesn't know anything about services. The platform knows everything about components. It knows nothing about services. Right? Right. WCF comes along in 2007, and it's a beautiful technology. You don't have to be a Michelle or a Clemens to do so anymore. You just put a little class, a little attribute, host open, you're done. It's a beautiful technology for doing the methodology. Now, given this trend that goes back to the 60s, this mega trend, why do you think it's going to stop right here, right now, and not progress to the next level? And the next level is a service-oriented language and a service-oriented runtime, where the basic atoms, every int, every class, and so on, is already a service. Now, I want to show you something. Do you see what I see? It's Visual Studio, by the way. It's a mock-up. It's actually running. It's compiling it and so on. I'm not saying it's going to be, you know, be a release product or anything. But they're clearly working on it. You saw it? Yes. Service-oriented language. Now, there's additional things that led me to believe that the next wave of the platform will be supporting services at the atomic level, every class being a service. And of course, if you have to make the decision today, wouldn't you like to be forward-looking to that platform? Yes. But we know every class should be a service. Not just because of performance, just because you want to be aligned with what is coming. But there's two other things that led me to believe that every class should be a service. The first is integration versus interoperability with legacy. Throughout the years, Microsoft was always very good at interoperating with its legacy GUI. The fact that you can take any DOS application running it on Vista 64 is amazing, right? So they can interoperate with legacy. But when it comes to developers, we actually make a distinction between integration versus interoperability. What does it mean? Every time Microsoft jumps technologies, there's always a preferred son. There's always this technology that tap on the shoulder and say, you're the one we like better than the rest. For example, let's talk about moving from unmanaged code to managed code. If you are doing just C++, there is no hope. Maybe if you have some DLLs, there's a little bit of hope, but then you have to kind of like guess what the signature and interop plan would look like. Good luck. But if you're using COM, it's transparent. Every COM object is a first-class .NET object. Every .NET object is a first-class COM object in COM land, right? You do nothing. All your legacy integrates with your new stuff. Don't do anything. If everything you did was a COM object, then you move to .NET is transparent, right? Hence, me saying in the 90s, every class should be a COM object. Now, if you were to follow my advice, say, 12 years ago, you would be much better off moving to .NET. It would be transparent. Right? Right. Now, they've silently done it again without telling you. We now realize that WCF is much more than, you know, this web services thing. And there is actually a preferred son. The preferred son is called COM Plus. Every COM Plus service component in .NET is immediately, without any changes whatsoever, a WCF service. And every WCF service can be consumed immediately without any changes by any legacy service component. How many of you knew that? Well, I haven't told you, actually. Well, I tell you the good things. Now, I've been saying for years, since .NET was released, every class should be a service component. How many of you have heard me saying that? Anybody? I've got witnesses, see? Now, imagine you were to follow my statement that every class should be a service component since 2002. Now you move to WCF, you don't actually move. You're already there. You do nothing, you're there. No, that's it. Just keep adding more stuff in WCF, and nothing changes in your system. Nothing. So why do they make this transitioning? Why do they not provide that with every technology? Why a preferred son? It turns out that this integration level interoperability thing is predicated on automatic translation or marshalling. Now, you can't do it, say, C++ to .NET because the C++ type system is open-ended. It's void star, right? What is void star? I don't know. By the way, what is void star star? It's a pointer I don't know. The pointer's another thing I don't know, right? How could you express these things in .NET? You cannot. But the COM type system is closed. It's IDL. It's only things you can express in IDL. The .NET type system is also closed. It's a CLI spec. If you have one closed system and another one, all you have to do is just map one construct to another, and a tool can do that. That's why they can consume COM object in .NET and export .NET to COM. Now let's look at service component. Service component is a closed system that has discrete features. Here's how you do security, here's how you do transaction, here's how you do remote calls and marshalling and so on. Same with WCF. It's based on some 20 standards of all the features it does. Just take one set of goo from here and another one, just marshal it, and then you can just integrate service components into WCF and the other way around. Let's extrapolate it further. Let's imagine a platform replacing .NET. What, do you think your grandchildren are going to be programming in .NET? Grandchildren, anyone? Anyone? No. You yourself 10 years from now? No. Every technology has a shelf life? Yes. At some point in time, going to be this PDC is going to be unveiling of this new platform, right? Okay. I'm willing to bet every WCF service will be a first-class citizen over there, no questions asked whatsoever. Why? Because we know that they're going to try and do this, the service-oriented language, service-oriented runtime, and so on. And so just take the WCF way of doing things and just convert that to the new platform way of doing things, and that's it. So if you were to make a decision today, trying to be forthcoming, trying to say, okay, I need to make things today that align my product for the next 7 years or whatever the time is, if you adopt WCF at the most granular level, you're incredibly well poised for the next change. In fact, let's try and come up with timelines here. Let me ask you a question. How old was COM when .NET retired it? Mighty COM. Well, COM was released in 1994. .NET was officially released in 2002. But it was actually available in beta since 2001. I mean, give or take, that would be 7-8 years. Good. How old is .NET? I'm sorry, I can't hear you. 7 or 8 years. Yes, interesting. Last time I checked, technology generations are only getting shorter, not getting longer, right? All things being equal, aren't we due for a change? Yes, we are. .NET is already long in the tooth. It's about to expire. However, managed code didn't die all at once into managed code. ATL came along. What is ATL? ATL, anybody here used ATL? ATL, anybody? Good. So for the rest of you, while you were playing with crayons and we were doing work, you had a problem. How do you take C++ class and make them COM objects? So you take ATL, and it's this framework. You take a C++ class, whoop, shimming it up, now it's a COM object, right? Now, ATL was released in patch B on MFC 4.2 in 1996. And we could just forget these things, okay? So 1996. So ATL gave C++ a shot in the arm until the managed component-oriented platform was ready, some 4 to 6 years later. Okay? Now, what is WCF? You take a C# class, boop, shim it up as a service. The analogy is perfect. WCF gives .NET a shot in the arm until the service-oriented platform will be ready. Now, if ATL gave a shot on the arm for another 5 years, 6 years, let's say 6 years. When was WCF released? November 2006. You had 6 years, what do you get? 2012. Let's look at it the other way, or another way at least. How many versions for Visual Studio were there in unmanaged land before .NET? 6. Let's count managed versions. Why? Because the beast can only cough up these versions at basically some kind of intervals pertaining to its size and capacity, right? So, how many versions were there for the .NET side? 2002? 2003? 2005? 2008? Service Pack 1? I'm counting this. It's a big release. I'm not calling it a release, okay? Could have called it VS 2009, right? Right? They've already announced VS 2010. How many versions? I'm willing to bet there won't be VS 2012. It's aligned. Let me show you something else. What we have here is an Intel executive holding a silicon wafer where every dot of light here is an 80-core CPU. Now, this is not science fiction. They're already building this. How come we haven't seen it in computer stores? Because they can still milk the market for the quad CPUs and so on. It's called market segmentation. Once they finish milking that, they'll release these guys. Now, we can go on and talk about why 80 cores. It's actually 64 because they have issues with synchronization. It's a grid of 8x8. But the problem is if you have 64 CPUs jumping on the bus to get the information, you need to synchronize so they can actually have synchronization CPUs. But then one thing they don't lack here is horsepower. So they actually have another 8 on this side of the grid, another 8 on this side of the grid for the sole purpose of synchronizing access to the bus. So you actually only have 64. Now, I can tell you that Intel has actually canceled this project. And they're going to move straight to the 256 cores by 2012. Interesting. Now, suppose we have a 256 CPU. We know that the average developer can't even handle threads. What are they going to do with 256 CPUs? I'll tell you. 255 of them are going to be doing this, and one of them is going to be red hot. You have any doubt? I have no doubt. I mean, if you start going there, what would task manager of a 256 core CPU look like? It would look like this. Okay. Now, we know it's coming. We can't train developers to come up with parallel algorithms for multiple cores and so on. The only way to deal with it is to provide it in the platform level. Probably even Windows itself is not good enough, okay? Now, suppose I'm trying to do things in a loop, kind of like the old way of doing it in C#. If I'm doing it like this in the same thread, I'm going to be utilizing one CPU, but suppose, I'm just speculating here, that every integer is a service, which means every call to every integer is intercepted, which means I can actually intersect something. You go to this CPU, this I++ goes to that CPU, and then I'm going to synchronize it at the end and just shove it back to the end of the loop. Yes, if every primitive is intercepted to that level, you can start utilizing these monsters. Which leads me to believe, from another angle, that every class should be a service. Now, also, interesting to note here is that all dates point at 2012. Now, the moment you're trying to speculate on something like this, we do it using different techniques and yield the same number, then you know it's around the corner. So, now we have fully answered the wrong question. The wrong question was what about performance? I think we understand that. We know that purely from the performance angle, everything should be a service. But that, sadly, is the wrong question to ask. We have the right question to ask. I'm going to go over time a little bit. Is that okay? I mean, I could just end it here. I've done my share. I've answered the question. You see, the real question is not about what about performance. The real question is what about... Yes, you get the book. Here you go. The real question is, what about productivity? How come none of you wanted to ask me, but, what are the productivity implications of treating every class as a service? That is a far more important question to answer. And it turns out WCF does have overhead, a significant overhead, but that overhead is not what you think. It's not a performance overhead. It's ownership overhead. What does it mean? Suppose you have a decent sized system with 200, 300 classes in it. 300 is not a big number for a decent system. If you were to try and use WCF at that level, what would the main method of 300 host open and host close look like? Well, I'll tell you. It's going to be the main method from hell. And if you have a config file, what would a config file with 300 service section and 300 client section look like? Well, I'll tell you, the config file from hell. WCF was never designed to be used at this level of granularity. It was designed to use just like Microsoft thought it would be, at the gateway of system as a web service. This is not new. They have stumbled on something they didn't intend to do. What was COM called before COM? OLE, object linking and embedding. Microsoft wanted to take an Excel spreadsheet and spread it and embed it inside Word. That's all they wanted to do. But what about PowerPoint and Excel? So they had to do it in a general manner. And it turns out that once they solved it in a general manner, they also unintendedly also solved the general problem of component orientation. And then they actually called it COM. The same thing happened here, actually. They didn't intend to come up with a superior way of programming, deprecating C#, but they did, actually. Now, what about this ownership overhead? WCF, as it is out of the box, sadly cannot be used at the granularity level we all know it should, at least if you care about performance. I didn't like it, so I came up with this, the in-proc factory. This class eliminates all ownership overhead of WCF. There are no hosts, there are no config files, there are no proxies. It is used just like C#. In fact, it's a very simple class. You give it the type of the class you want to create, but you say, I'm going to create this S type over WCF. Don't create it for me over C#. So if I were to run this demo for you, look at what I have here. I have here a project. There is no config file. There is no host open in main. There's nothing. It's just I'm going to create this interface. And I'm saying, please create me this class and give me back this interface out of it. Now, what's with this funky syntax? Conceptually, this syntax is analogous to this syntax. In both cases, I'm saying, look, please give me instantiate type A and give it to me in a form of type B, right? Now, how come I don't have to do a cast here? It's because compiler trickery is going on. C# has compiler support for interfaces. The compiler is examining my service, sees it support my contract, and suddenly does the interpretive cast for me, okay? I do not have compiler support. So I have to do it like this. Please create for me an instance of this type, give me back a reference for this type. I don't have compiler support, so I have to do it like this. But semantically, these two lines are the same. Instantiate this type, give me a reference for this type. And so this call goes over C# now. This call goes out over WCF now. Now, it's optional to also close the proxy. You don't have to close it. Nothing's going to happen. It's using IPC and then pipe underneath. If you don't want to close it, don't close it. Right? Let's run it. First call over C#, second call over WCF. So syntactically or semantically it's the same, syntactically it's not. You can take it a step further, and I have a helper class I call the WCF wrapper that actually, if you look at what it's doing inside, it's actually wrapping the in-proc factory and doing some other things for you. All you have to do is if you want to invoke or use the class MyService over WCF, just wrap it with the WCF wrapper, and then you can get the following code. Look, here's my class, here's an object, new, use it. This is now indistinguishable from C#, and yet every call here goes out over WCF. We've completely and utterly negated the ownership overhead of WCF while maintaining all the benefits. Now, if I can do... Now... If I can do it dancing at the top, what can they do dancing on the inside? A lot more. What the in-proc factory and friends show you here is that it is technically possible, feasible, desirable to treat every class as a service. There are no implications on productivity whatsoever if you use these things. In fact, that system I told you when I was testing it with WCF and C#, I wasn't just, you know, going massaging every class. I did a massive search and replace where I placed every new with in-proc factory to create instance and back. That's nothing. If you've already embraced the separation of interface for implementation in C# land, moving your entire system to WCF is as simple as a single find and replace over all your code base. I'm not suggesting you do it because you already have your own plumbing, your own logging, your own security, and so on. That would probably buy you more damaged and good, because you're going to have to gut out all your security and all your transactions and so on. And if it's already working and you already paid for the cost of it, you know, water under the bridge, bygones. But moving forward, Why not? Okay? And there are some other things I can talk about, cost and such, but you get the idea. Some resources for you. The helper classes I showed you and so on are all in my second edition of my book. Also, I have here a few CDs with the demos I just did. I'm almost running out, so the first to grab it. You can also go to the IDesign website, where there's information about masterclasses I do all over the world. I do a WCF masterclass, which is a 5 days WCF, and an architect masterclass, where what I showed you today is actually highlights for that. So please fill the evaluations, and thank you.